Howdy, welcome back to another episode of Reel to Reel, the most trustworthy movie review program on the internet. I am your returning noted film critic, Nick.
And I'm your other returning noted film critic, Aiden.
Well, it's rewind time. We're going back to 1993 with the summer classic, The Sandlot.
In November.
Regardless, roll the trailer.
I know you're smart, and I'm proud of you. I want you to make some friends this summer.
Meet Scotty Smalls.
Kale, get it!
The kid is a L7 weenie.
My life is over.
Man, this is baseball. You gotta stop thinking. Just have fun.
Climb trees, hop fences, get into trouble.
Just stand there and stick your glove out in the air. I'll take care of it.
Now he's in.
Yeah! All right!
With the coolest guys in the neighborhood. They've got the look.
Wendy Peppercorn.
Wow. Hey, girls.
They've got the moves. They've got the rap.
Blockhead!
Geek!
Jerk!
Idiot!
Moron!
You bob for apples in the toilet! And you like it!
You play ball like a girl!
Yeah!
Something else has got their ball.
That wasn't my ball!
Dad's father gave it to him.
Babe Ruth signed that ball.
Babe Ruth!
We gotta get that ball back.
Got any bright ideas?
Initiate retrieval section number one. Power connect. Come on, homie, it's heavy.
Now.
Fire, fire!
Big doggy.
20th Century Fox presents...
Hey, guys, it's the Sandlot babies.
You're the ones that are making all that racket.
A lifetime of adventure.
Come on, Squid, you can do it. Pull through, bud. Little pervert.
Gila. The Sandlot. A little piece of paradise, a half a block wide, and a whole season long.
Scotty, have you made any friends yet?
Oh! Oh, I'm sorry, Mom!
Directed by David Mickey Evans in his only big film of his career, and starring Tom Geary, Mike Vitar, Karen Allen, Dennis Leary, and James Earl Jones.
Set in 1962, Scott Smalls and his family moves into the San Fernando Valley neighborhood, and his mother encourages him to go out and make some friends. He joins a group of boys who play baseball. Benny, Ham, Squints, Yaya, the Heater, Beecham, Timmy, and Repeat.
He knows nothing about baseball, which the kids tease him for, so his stepdad tries to teach him how to play catch, which results in Smalls getting a black eye.
After some resistance from the boys, he learns how to play, and also the story of a supposed killer dog that lives next door of the Sandlot, known as the Beast.
One day, Smalls decides to use his stepdad's baseball that had been signed by baseball legend Babe Ruth. However, the ball ends up going over the fence into the dog's compound.
Smalls gets grounded and gets visited by the ghost of Babe Ruth, Christmas Carol style, where he learns to believe in the power of baseball by getting the ball back from the dog. And that's what the kids end up doing. It's a classic coming-of-age story.
It's simple. It's a simple movie, and with that, let's check out a clip from the movie.
Too much.
Smiling.
For Michael Squints Polidorus.
I can't take this no more! Move!
And he did the most desperate thing.
Squints, come on!
Wake up!
Come on, Squidge, you can do it! Pull through, bud!
Come on, man, come on!
Yeah, he looks pretty crappy.
Squidge! Come on, man!
Oh, God, he looks like a dead fish.
The film had a $7 million budget and grossed $4 million on its opening week. Present day, with CD and VHS sales, the gross amount is now around $76 million.
The Sandlot has two sequels, The Sandlot 2 and The Sandlot Heading Home. They announced a TV series in 2019, and in 2023, they had to cancel the series with the original cast due to the actor's strike.
Fun fact, for the carnival scene, they actually made the chewing tobacco out of licorice and bacon bits. The actors later said that with the fake tobacco combined with the carnival rides, with all the takes they did, made them as sick as their fictional counterparts.
When the young cast weren't acting, they were getting into the kind of shenanigans that their Sandlot alter ego surely would have been proud of. For example, one night they snuck in the theater to see the movie Basic Instinct.
The Sandlot was at the center of a lawsuit. Michael Polidoro sued 20th Century Fox, claiming that his former classmate, David Mickey Evans, had based the character of Squints on him, and that it caused him embarrassment and humiliation. The judge decided that there wasn't enough similarity to rule in favor of Michael.
The giant oak tree that held the treehouse was actually salvaged from someone's yard that was close to the production office. Salt Lake City's utility companies took down power and telephone lines on certain streets so the tree could be hauled safely to the empty lot where filming was taking place.
And during the 43 days of shooting, the weather wasn't so nice. It was a mixture of being super hot around the 110s and being pretty cold, especially during the pool scene where you can actually see Squint's teeth chatter.
You're killing me, Smalls, with all these facts. Those lights don't keep themselves on. Roll the commercial.
We really try and keep track of what's going on in the world as far as what are the trends. And so when a student comes here, they're learning the marketing aspects of video production with turnkey. So they learn how to write, storyboard, and capture video, set lights, set audio, and then they learn how to edit everything from start to finish.
We believe that we are providing a transformative educational experience. It's hands-on, it's project-based, it's portfolio-based, it's based on real-world industry experiences.
They take deep dives on all of these. You know, a lot of the classes are tiered, so you get an entry-level course and then an advanced, and then, you know, you hit your capstone projects where you're bringing them all together. So it's nice the way that they structure it and help you get a deeper understanding of stuff that you may or may not have thought you already had a good handle on.
The last time I saw this movie was in eighth grade, when our English class did a film studies type of thing with this film and Kubrick's Dr. Strangelove. Upon my recent rewatch, this film's a classic. Now I can say it's perfect, but I really enjoyed it. For the most part, I like the chemistry of the kids, it tells an interesting story, and the whole story of the dog really feels like what the movie is going for. An impactful summer with your friends during your childhood. In terms of coming-of-age stories, I can say it's on par with, like, The Graduate, Stand By Me, or The Outsiders. But it's still pretty high up. But come on, it wouldn't be one of my reviews if I didn't have something to complain about, so here we go. There's some minor scenes where the kids' acting come across as unintentionally annoying. Secondly, the amount of interest I have in baseball is non-existent. So when the movie gets into stuff like who Babe Ruth was, it's a little hard for me to care. But one of the main scenes I always hated was the scene we just watched where the kid pretends to drown and the lifeguard tries to save him. Even when I was in school, it made me uncomfortable, and it's just my least favorite scene in the movie. Overall, I do still really like this movie, even if I don't get baseball, It has memorable characters and a pretty enjoyable story. It's a crowd pleaser. It feels like watching an episode of The Wonder Years. The story of the dog is absolutely my favorite part of the movie. I'll be generous and give this movie a 4 out of 5 reels. If you're going by a traditional out of 10, it'd probably be like a 7. It's a classic that everyone should see at least once in their lives. And thankfully, there were no direct-to-video sequels ever made. So what did you think of it?
This movie has been one of my all-time favorite movies as a kid, and even to this day, it is still one of my favorites. Rewatching this movie reminded me of what I used to do with my childhood friends, playing baseball, and after practice, getting into some trespassing shenanigans. You know, what kids are supposed to do at that age. I really liked the narration from the adult Scotty. I think it really fits this movie and helped its story go farther and more noticed. This movie is a perfect example of what it means to do a simple story right. There was a simple plot and concept which allowed the kids to have each of their funny and quirky personalities shine. To me, that's way more important than flashy action scenes or crazy VFX. I was actually more sucked into this movie than some of the recent movies that came out this year. Surprisingly, this movie has some good shot composition. I never really paid much attention to it than just now when I rewatched it. The slight camera movements that follow the character's actions, like when Scotty would sit in a chair or a close-up of one of the kids' faces, it really helps you get sucked into the scene. Even as a kid, I always laughed at the sound effects for Hercules. To me, it's just ridiculous that the beast sounded like a dinosaur mixed with a dog. However, it really does match with what a kid would be thinking and exaggerating when they are that age. Scotty is probably my favorite character because of his awkwardness and quirkiness. I just love his interactions with the characters, especially with Ham. The carnival scene is by far one of my favorites due to the whole chewing tobacco disaster that ensues. It always makes me chuckle when I see them pop some chew in their mouth and then think it's a great idea to go on a carnival ride. There isn't much that I dislike about the movie. The only thing I would say is that some of the transitions and editing were very corny and outdated. It is a 90s movie, but still, it wasn't my taste for transitions. This movie is a fantastic coming-to-age sports movie and an all-time favorite of mine, so I'm obviously going to give this a 5 out of 5 reels. The pros of this movie heavily outweigh the cons.
Well, on that note, we are approaching the end of our show.
Don't forget to tune in to our next show at noon. If you're watching this on YouTube, make sure you hit the subscribe button and hit the notification bell to receive updates of new uploads.
If you're watching this on our Facebook page, make sure you follow us and you'll be notified the next time we go live.
Again, my name is Forever Aiden, and along with my friend here, Forever Nick, we hope to see you next time on
Reel to Reel.